Roger enjoyed muscle cars, and he proudly owned a Corvette, knew how to mess around with them, and he loved those cars. He also, when he was driving on the freeway, liked to point out the Valmont light poles as he traveled the interstates. I'm not sure if he slowed down for that or not, but he sure noticed them. I guess they have a distinctive shape or size or something. He loved his Husker football club. I'm sure if you're one of the neighbors, you know that, because he had a stash of fireworks that he kept from the rocket run, and when they made a touchdown, he was quick to fire off a rocket. So if that happened to be your afternoon nap time, sorry. Or if it was early on the day of the 4th of July, bam, blam, he started the day off right with a set of rockets so loud that there was no sleeping in for anyone around. I'm glad he wasn't my neighbor, I gotta say. He played golf, and listen to this. He made his own clubs. He made his own clubs, and he had no problem junking them on the course if he had a bad round. So someone in the family got deputized to go back to the course, go find the clubs that got left there in a huff, and bring them back home. True, isn't it? Anybody? Yeah, they're nodding. That's a case. He volunteered as the fire chief. He was an ordained deacon in this congregation. He was a member of the Air National Guard, and he was, I'm just going to say it, he was a sore loser. He lost a round of canasta. I don't know if that meant the cards get tossed, or the huff started, or the glass got tipped over, but mild-mannered Roger did not like to lose a canasta. After 40 years at Valmont, he took on several part-time jobs to stay busy. There was no sitting around for him. You might have seen him driving a school bus, or zooming around a baseball field on the mower, or attending to the care of special needs students on the bus. You might have, because he worked right up until the day he died. He was an easygoing guy with a sense of humor. He was close with his parents. His dad, Howard, lived to 105. And Roger would take his folks out for Sunday drives. Well, you know, if you're driving your car around that much, sometimes you got to take it in for service. And he took it in one day to get it serviced, maybe an oil change. And that's where he met Linda. And they ended up getting married. Thank you, said Dylan. Looks like some of us need to go and get our vehicles serviced. Roger was a member of this congregation for more than 20 years. He was ordained to the office of deacon, as I've mentioned, but I might also say that in our tradition, a deacon means that you look out for the frail and the elderly, for the vulnerable, for members maybe who are in need of care because a family member has been hospitalized. It's the kind of office in the church where we look for people who have a kind word and a good heart and a helpful hand. So you can see why he was a deacon, can't you? As I've mentioned, immediately following the service, there is the interment. And then there'll be time for us in the fellowship hall to recall all the wonderful stories of Roger's life. On behalf of Brenda and Mike in Canada and Fremont, on behalf of Brad from Overland Park, Kansas City, where we might be able to get a story or two from, on behalf of Karen Larson and Roger's beloved grands and great-grands, Abby Wharf and her son Easton, Ellen Kincannon and her children Reese and Jackson, especially Reese, because he and I are going to have a competition to see who can eat the most cookies at the reception. This was his great-grandpa. We welcome you to this service of worship, where we thank God for the life of Roger H. Meyer Henry. Please, will you ponder all the things in him that were wonderful and good and kind.
Trees are green, red roses too. I
Wonderful world, and it was created by God, and we are made in the image of God, but not one of us has been able to live without sin. All of us bump into one another and create drama and pain and suffering. Presbyterians understand that we are created by God, but we are very far from God, and so at the beginning of our worship services, we offer a prayer of confession, where we might demonstrate to God, we know that we have failed, but with grateful hearts, we gather here knowing that you gather us up anyway and make us right and set us on the right road. Let us this day cleanse our hearts, redeem our memories, and renew our confidence in the goodness of God as we pray our prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, you formed us from the dust of the earth, and by your breath you gave us life. We forget that our life comes from you, and that to you all life returns. We have not always sought or done your will. Set us free from a past that we cannot change, and open to us a future in which we live faithfully, and grant us your grace, that we may honor you all the days of our life until we dwell in your house forever. Amen and amen. Just like terrific parents who are always watching and helping, better than any earthly parents we can imagine, God is watching us and helping us and cheering for us. God sent his only Son, Jesus Christ, that we might have the best example that there is. Friends, hear and believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. We should lay down our burden and know that we are forgiven and that we will have opportunities to get it right and to make amends. Thanks.
I want
Whenever we gather to worship, we read from scriptures because scripture is where the source of true wisdom is. It's words that can calm the troubled waters of our hearts. It can be an opportunity to still your own voice and to listen for the voice of God. Gracious God, may this day we hear your spirit and obey what you tell us in your word. The power of your Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Ellen, are you ready to go first? You want to go to the lectern?
Shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters and restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparedest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
To the hills, where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will not neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will help you from all harm. He watches over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. May God grant you always a sunbeam to warm you, a moonbeam to charm you, a sheltering angel so nothing can harm you, laughter to cheer you, faithful friends near you, and wherever you pray, heaven to hear you.
While your mom does a do-over, Reese, do you want to come up here and we'll sit by the manger so you can see where the baby Jesus is going to be put on Christmas Eve? Would that be all right, babe?
Have no fear for what tomorrow may bring. The same loving God who cares for you today will take care of you tomorrow and every day. God will either shield you from suffering or give you unfailing strength to bear it. Be at peace then and put aside all anxious thoughts and imaginations.
Small person cry at a funeral, that's the first. So now, let me see if I can make you cry. Name all the people you can name from the Bible. Ready, go. It's not a test, but it is kind of funny. I think if you named and named and named, oh, who would get people from the Bible? Anybody? Who?
Moses.
Mary and Joseph. Noah. Jonah. Jesus. Oh, see? I knew you were the favorite son-in-law. Jesus. Nice one. Anybody else? Rachel. Wow, that was a good random one. Okay, those are writers. Yeah, okay, I'll give it to you, Mike. I don't know if I should give it to him. Give it to him or not. Let's take it away from him and see if he cries. Ooh, that's a yucky story. Yeah, brothers that could never figure out how to get along. I'd like to read you a little slice of Colossians. It's a letter from the Apostle Paul, and he's writing to the church in Colossae. So this is the Apostle Paul. In our prayers for you, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus, and of the love that you have for all the saints because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. You have heard of this hope before in the word of the truth, the gospel that has come to you, just as it is bearing fruit and growing in the whole world. So it has been bearing fruit among yourselves from the day you heard it and truly comprehended the grace of God. This you learned from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf, and he has made known to us your love in the Spirit. Epaphras gets two more shout-outs in Scripture. Another one is from this same letter, chapter 4, verse 12. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ Jesus, greets you. He's always wrestling in his prayers on your behalf, so that you may stand mature and fully assured in everything that God wills. For I testify for him that he has worked hard for you and for those in Laodicea and in Hierapolis. There's one more shout out, and it's in that tiny, tiny book of Philemon, where a slave or a servant is returned to the Christian community. Epaphras. I think if I held you hostage here for hours, naming every name we could come up with in the Bible, we would have been hard-pressed to come up with this guy's name. He's mentioned three times in Scripture. He was with the Apostle Paul. He was a wingman, maybe. He was a person who taught the faith to the people of Colossae, the grace of God in truth. Scripture tells us he worked hard. Once when Paul was in prison, it was Epaphras who brought him news and supplies and care. It was Epaphras who showed up there to remind the prisoner Paul that he wasn't forgotten, he wasn't left, he wasn't abandoned, and he spent time with Paul so that Paul would not despair in the circumstances that he found himself in. Paul described Epaphras as our beloved fellow servant, a faithful minister to others, a quiet and prayerful man, maybe the kind that would send prayers and beams of hope via text if he lived in this day and age. Did any of you receive a beam or a poem or a prayer from Roger recently? I hear they were quite frequent and right up until the last. Epaphras. I kind of think of Roger like that. An easygoing guy with a sense of humor, a kind soul, a guy who was at ease working behind the scenes, not like Paul out there in front with the big fancy words and the loads of education and drawing a crowd. Nope. Not like Peter with his brash activity. Nope. Just steadily, behind the scenes, prayerfully fixing things, calming things, organizing things, and looking after the frail and the vulnerable. Roger lived on a farm outside Blair in a place called Telebasta. There's absolutely no reason for me to put that in the sermon, except I wanted to say Telebasta. Maybe you would like to say it too. Isn't it cool? It just, wow, I think we should all make a pilgrimage there to get t-shirts of some kind from the Telebasta Inn or the Telebasta Diner or the, I don't know what's in Telebasta now, but that is a, oh, I don't need a t-shirt from the cemetery, thank you. Maybe the good times in Kansas City weren't that exciting. Now, Roger was kind of modest and unassuming even then. The family had a car. It wasn't a giant truck or some sort of transport. So when a 4-H calf or a calf had to go into town, you can hear this coming, right? It had to go in the back seat of the car in order to be transported. And Reese, I don't know if your mama ever does anything that you just find so embarrassing, but that's what your great-grandpa did. He took a cow, calf, and put it in the back seat of the car, and then they drove it to town. It's what his parents said they had to do, and he just was like, oh, I hope nobody I know can see this happening. He understood how things had to happen behind the scenes, and that's where he worked, praying things up. Even when he was a bus driver, I bet the people who got in and off the bus and the people who received their children on and off the bus, they might know his name, they might not know his name, they might recognize him, they might not even look at him. He's one of those people that could be invisible in the job that they do. Not that it's a job that's invisible, it's just that we pass by them. The person at the door, the person who punches the ticket, the person who takes your forms and signs them. Maybe none of those kids on the bus knew his name, or maybe if they knew it, they couldn't say it, but it doesn't matter at all, because Roger attended to their care and safety, whether his name was mentioned or not. He died and went on to his dear and faithful Savior, and we cannot know if they've already played a round or to a gull for how that went, but we understand that all things can be redeemed, so perhaps there's no chucking the golf clubs wherever it is that he is. When we teach our Krishna faith, we understand and explain heaven like this. In heaven, we shall be united with the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and with one another. There we will see at last, face to face, what we only can glimpse now as through a distant mirror. Our deepest, truest delights in this life are only a dim foreshadowing of the delights that await us in heaven. The Bible says, "You show me the path of life." In your presence, there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore. So let's all know that where Roger is now, he is seated with his faithful Savior, and there is no pain, and there is no crying, and there are no tears, and there is no sorrow, and he has entered the place prepared for him. And we here on earth go on, missing his stories and his laughter and his instructions and his wisdom. But we too will one day enter the place that the Savior has prepared for us. We each of us accomplish good and valuable contributions here before we go. And let us follow the example of Roger Meyer Henry, not running out ahead of the crowd in order to take credit, but working, oh, working, so that the world might be better, just like Epaphras did. Thanks be to God. I'd like to offer a prayer today. I know we are from many different traditions. I'd like to conclude this prayer with the Lord's Prayer, so we have different words for that. Some of us are trespassers, some of us are debtors, some of us are sinners. Some of us are going to stop the prayer when the Protestants are going to go on for another phrase. And I am absolutely clear that God can hear the prayers of our hearts and can sort out our words. Will you join me in prayer? Our mighty God, in Jesus Christ, you promised many rooms within your house, and we thank you that Roger's life on earth, though it is over, that you have received him into the heavenly home, the place of joy and delights, sorrow and sighing and pain are no more. We ask that you would comfort all those who grieve. We thank you for our time with Roger to learn from his wisdom and his abilities, his good and kind and faithful ways, his sharing the work and laughter of the ministry of the church. And we thank you for the hope in Jesus, that we too may bravely walk our earthly way and look forward to a glad reunion in the life to come through Jesus Christ our Lord. With all of our joy and sorrow, we offer our prayer today using the words our Savior taught us when praying to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. worship means the work of the people, and our work here is nearly done. Would you stand and join me for the commendation? Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Roger. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. When Jesus was getting ready to leave his disciples, he told them, I leave my peace with you. My peace is not like the world gives. I give you a peace that passes understanding. Would you turn to someone and say, peace be with you? And now let us go from this place to do the interment. And the blessing of God be upon us now and remain with us forevermore. Is telling me, don't you forget to come back, because Reese and Sarah are going to eat a lot of cookies and you need to be seeing how this goes down. You are all welcome in the fellowship hall after.